Fair.
And the crowd's here for a 4-star. This could be it. This is it!
Not going to see this, well, I'm not running your stream, so I guess I won't see the intro. I'll check it out.
Yeah, check it out later, it's sick.
Are you kidding me? Did that just happen?
Ugh.
What?
Dude, I'm ready to drink. Wait, how esports are we? How esports is your
channel? It's not esports enough for you to not be able to drink, so you can definitely do that.
Well, I won't do it now.
Alright, so welcome guys to, like I said, the first live edition of the Pardon the Interruption Smash edition. Thanks so much to Starsky, by the way, for hooking it up with that intro and all the lovely graphics you see here. Thanks so much, dude, for the hookup. Show definitely looks a lot better now. And without further ado, let's go ahead and get started with the first topic, which is Smash 4 impressions. And the game has been out for long enough, I think, for us to really talk about how we feel about the game and stuff like that. So with that in mind, Hugs, how do you feel about Smash 4?
So I think it's in a tough spot right now. I think it needs to be more spectator-friendly. And I understand that some people are hyped about watching it right now, but there's not enough craziness or speed or offense going on enough for it to last a very long time. It needs to get fixed. And then there's issues with certain characters, but I think that's fine. I think people are overreacting with some characters being way too good. But I really think this is kind of bold and kind of mean, unless Nintendo like changes it up with their patches. But year and a half. Unless the spectator aspect of it gets way better. How are you going to watch that and then compare it to watching Melee and then just feel like, I'd just rather watch this. Like, there's way too much hype going on. It's got a competitor in its own backyard.
Right.
It needs to step it up with the spectator.
Yeah, no, I completely agree. And as far as it being a good competitive game, I think that's a totally different question entirely. It might be a good competitive game, but as far as the spectator aspect of it, like, the game is just not that appealing to watch when you compare it to something like Melee or even, like, a Project M or something like that. It's just not the same level of hype that it brings to the table, and I think that's pretty clear already. Hopefully Nintendo can do something to change that with patches. I'm kind of doubtful, you know, with the game engine already being what it is. It's hard to imagine that they would patch it so much that it would somehow create hype out of this engine that already seems to promote, like, anti-hype. So I pretty much have to agree. I can't see the game lasting competitively more so than, like, a year to two. So, unfortunately, because, you know, it's cool that Nintendo's trying to support the competitive community, but the gameplay just isn't there.
Yeah. I want it to succeed.
Yeah, for sure.
They gotta change it up.
Definitely.
That's what I think.
And so next up we have the other Smash game that we talk about quite a lot, Super Smash Bros. Melee. It's recently celebrated its 13-year anniversary, and at this point it remains to be seen really what Melee's future holds, but I think we have a pretty good idea of that so far. So, Hugs, what do you think is in store for Melee's future?
Okay, I'm going to make a bold prediction and say we're going to agree 100% on this. I think Melee has got quite a few years left in it. I think it's super exciting. It's got support from all kinds of other esports. They love watching it, too. And, you know, the events are not slowing down. They're still getting bigger. We're still breaking records in attendance. It's hype to watch. Fox might be an issue. I don't think personally it's an issue, but if too many people start playing it, you know how trends go. People want to play these characters
right.
that are popular. And that could, you know, kind of slow things down. So we need some low-tier heroes. But I think it's got a couple more years. With the documentary coming out that Samox is doing, that's just going to rejuvenate it once more. Nintendo has a gold mine, man.
Yeah.
HD.
Oh, man. That would be amazing, dude. I mean, that's the dream for sure. Like, Melee HD remake on Wii U with online play and all that good stuff would be incredible. But I think regardless of that, I mean, we're pretty much in agreement once again. Like, Melee is going to be around for a long time. There's no way it's going anywhere. The game still continues to develop. And I'm not going to go too much into the Fox thing because we're going to talk about that later on too, but I think that regardless of how there's only, let's say, 7 or 8 like truly tournament viable characters, I think regardless of that, within that 7 or 8, there's so much discrepancy of people learning new stuff, changing the matchups, and it's never really like a guaranteed win when you're at least in that tier of characters. So I think that gives the game longevity, and obviously just the game in itself being so technical and hype, like, it's just the fact that you can never really be perfect in Melee kind of guarantees that people will be playing it for a really long time, because always want to achieve perfection. So
even the top players still make dumb mistakes,
right,
big tournaments, so it's definitely going to stick around. Yeah
for sure. And so, switching gears a little bit, something a little different, we have Carissa the Destroyer. Now, this was something that was a little bit controversial when it first happened, I would say. Basically, this 10-year-old girl showed up at this GameStop event and started beating everyone in Smash 4, including pro players like XX and Tyrant and stuff like that. And it became really big news, got picked up by a lot of different gaming websites like Kotaku and stuff like that. As you can see the video here, she beat a lot of big names. And then the next day it came out that the whole thing was a hoax. They hired actors for it, and apparently there was some other player really behind her. Of course, now we know that's KDJ, but a lot of Smashers were upset when they found out that it wasn't really this 10-year-old girl playing this, beating all these top players. So what's your take on the whole situation, Hugs?
It was just a joke. Last time I checked, it was just a joke. And I feel like if you have a problem with this, then you should not laugh when Pepsi dresses up an old man to play basketball. dresses up Kyrie Irving to go dunk on a bunch of fools at a basketball court as an old man. You know, I feel like people get upset when the prank, when they're the butt of the joke. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Are you still there? I heard it. Yeah. Did it lag out? Okay. No, it's when they're the butt of the joke, they get really mad. But when they're not, then they just find it hilarious. And I understand that there was an issue where there's a lot of people who thought a girl really did this. When I saw this, I just was thinking 10-year-old. Yeah. I was like, damn, this 10-year-old's really doing it. I didn't even think boy, girl. It was a 10-year-old doing it, and that's what was crazy. And once I found out it wasn't, it was like, haha, okay, that's cool. Actually,
right.
I knew way ahead of time. I was a backup, and I'm very glad they didn't use me instead of Green DJ, because I would have gotten bodied. When they told me, I was like, oh, it's going to be like a commercial and like actors. Yeah. It's going to be cool. But I didn't know they actually expected me to beat on like Tyrant and XX. I wasn't gonna do any. I hadn't been practicing.
Yeah, so yeah. I don't think it was really an issue of the fact that it was a girl so much. That part I didn't really agree with that people were upset about. Like, I also just thought it was like cool that a 10-year-old was doing it or whatever. But I think just the way that it was revealed like got on some people's nerves, and I kind of understand it. But I do think all of it was a little bit overblown for sure. So. Let's see.
It was, I don't know. People blew it out of proportion. It was just a joke. Yeah. They just didn't like that they were the butt of it. And first of all, why did they even believe that a 10-year-old was stomping on people?
Yeah.
Come on. Think about it. Like,
that is
your fault for believing that crap.
That's definitely true.
What happened?
A lot of people didn't believe. I told Azen when it first happened, he just straight up didn't buy it. Yeah. He was like, no, that's BS.
Can't happen.
Yeah. All right, so next up here, we have the Melee at Omni rankings. For the second year in a row, Melee at Omni is ranking every Melee player, or at least most active players that have gone to majors, and they're doing it with just a panel of 30 players, commentators, figures, whatever it might be. And so far, we're 50 down the list. The top 50 remains to be seen. But so far, how do you feel about the rankings, Hugs?
So they're a lot crazier than they were last year.
Agreed.
I don't agree with some spots. Like Connor is ranked way too low.
Come on,
are you going to tell me Scar is better than Connor? Or like, Scar's not even active. Like, come on, everyone knows better. One thing I find hilarious is that DOH always gets mad about his ranking. He's done it every year, but like we talked about it here, like we're always impressed with how accurate his ranking is. Every time he comes up, it is like dead on. But I think like the rankings are okay. There's just some that are way off, way weird. I think there's a little too much emphasis on popularity to get ranked higher. I think it's excellent that we're both top 50, guaranteed already. I mean, unless we got snubbed, but like, that'd be famous, right? If we got snubbed, we could just, you know, forget about the whole list. But I think it's cool. I think it's great. Every year it comes out, it's so hype. Like I said it on my Twitter, it's Shark Week for Smashers. You just get hype about these upcoming 2 weeks. Everyone's getting mad at each other, salty.
I agree that it's, like, it's great for the community, even though the accuracy of the list itself is debatable. Like, most, of, especially, like, the lower ranks aren't accurate, because there's no way to accurately, like, place people like that. So, and I feel like the way he ranks them, he just has you give everyone a number out of 10. And because of that, people have might have different scales. Like, someone might think that, like, a 7 is really good, whereas someone else is like, oh, a 7 sucks. So I think that skews the rankings a little bit, too. But overall, really good for the community and creates a lot of hype. So,
yeah. Where do you think you're going to be?
I honestly think I'm going to end up exactly where I was last year, 26. I could see myself being, like, within one or two spots of 26.
I think it'll be 25 to 30. Yeah. I'm hoping for 30 to 40 around that range.
Yeah, that's where I'd put...
better, but I messed up sometimes.
Yeah, so that's where I would expect you to be just based on that. And like I said, I don't really consider them...
put freaking Dark Reign ahead of me or something. Like, I know... Oh, Dark Reign? Yeah, for sure. He's hype. Dark Reign ahead of Hugs.
Yeah. Whatever. Yeah, and a lot of the...
That's the Dark Reign, though. He's the homie.
I mean, a lot of the rankings are also influenced just by, like, who creates hype and stuff like that. Like I said, not the most accurate, but good for the community overall.
Yeah, yeah.
So, moving along in that same kind of vein of discussion, as far as rankings go, it's definitely shaken up a lot by Do You Fox With It, NorCal's Melee Apex Qualifier, where Mewtwo King was the only guy in attendance and ended up 13th. And then the top five was all Fox players, minus Fly. So, with that in mind, Hugs, how do you feel about the future of Melee's metagame, and do you think Fox is the future?
I do not think it's as people are making it out to be. It was just a bad look. And that's all it was. As soon as I found out these Foxes in the top five, like, I forgot who I turned to, but I was like, this looks really bad. But, you know, everyone's going to latch on to it. It's like, oh, Fox, 20XX. I don't think it's that bad. Mewtwo King had a rough tournament. That's how we do on the West Coast. Look at that, dude. We'll talk about that later with the qualifiers. But, you know, it was a great tournament. It was a lot of fun. The Foxes are top-level players to begin with. They just happen to play Fox, and they happen to beat Pupiu. They happen to beat Fly. They happen to beat Mewtwo King. They just, they're top players in their own right. They've been top players. Like, we can't act like they just picked up a Fox and just did amazing.
Yeah.
There's another day they did all this.
My whole thing is that all these players did amazing on this day, but all of them are inconsistent because that's the issue with Fox, is inconsistency. Fox can be far and away the best character in the game, but to play him like that constantly, consistently, is really, really hard. So I think all these Fox players finally had a day where they all had a good day at the same time, which is really rare because there's so many different good Fox mains, like, and they're also inconsistent for the most part. There's very few, there's like almost no such thing as a consistent Fox main at this point. So the fact that they all had that great day at the same time, that's why we saw that top five all Foxes. I definitely don't think it's something we're going to be seeing regularly in the future, and I definitely don't think that it's like an indication that Fox is broken or that the metagame's going to turn into 20.
I don't think Fox is broken. Have you been hit with IRL balance yet? The Fox IRL balance?
What's IRL balance?
When your wrist gets fucked up, you can't play the game anymore.
Not yet, dude. No? I'm scared of it. I've been watching out for it on purpose. I take my breaks and stuff like that, so...
Your hand stretches.
Yeah, all that good stuff. So, Do You Fox With It was one of the Apex qualifiers, which all have a $1,000 pot bonus from Twitch, which is really hype, and of course they all qualify you to get further in the Apex bracket automatically. So, Hugs, how are you feeling about the upcoming Apex qualifiers?
Same way I feel about any kind of qualifiers. The West Coast ones are way harder. Straight up. I mean, you got... Look, DJ Nintendo is a good player, but he's winning his over there, so he's an Apex qualifier champion, and Mewtwo King couldn't even win his. Granted, Hax won it, but he lost to two West Coast players.
Right.
Not Hax, Mewtwo King. And then this weekend, tomorrow, we have, you know, thanks to the gods, Mewtwo King and Mango are not here this weekend, but we still, instead of dealing with 7 top 20 threats, we have to deal with 5.
Right.
Plus McCain, who's probably top 25, plus Larry, plus me, plus Arizona's here. It's like, come on. It's way the dis. I don't like the idea of qualifiers to begin with because the distribution of skill is not fair in the United States of America.
I mean, that's totally fair, and I'll give you that. But I mean, we don't even have a single qualifier in MDVA. I think like the West Coast is definitely stacked, and the qualifiers are harder. But you guys also got way more qualifiers as far as Apex goes, I think, which also might be because Apex is on the East Coast, so it gives you guys more of a chance to qualify for it or whatever. But regardless, like, I just hate the fact that MDVA doesn't have a single one. It makes it really difficult for me. Like, I'm probably gonna hit I went to KTAR. I might be able to go to one or two more qualifiers, but I'm not sure. Do you know the specifics of how many people move on to, like, a specific part of the bracket or whatever?
No, you just get points, and then they seed you based on that. Like,
but I heard that, like, people actually get to skip pools or something like that. Did you hear that?
Oh, really?
Yeah.
I didn't hear about that.
Yeah, no, that's what made me, I was like, oh, then it's actually, like, really worth it to get qualified. Like,
we should just skip pools to begin with. Like,
yeah, no, right.
I feel like tournaments. Hey, Blur, you're in the chat, dude. Cut the shit, just put us in a bracket, man. Let them fight it out.
All right. And then next, a very fun topic, the Apex Salty Sweet, and our last topic of the day. There's quite a few matches already lined up for this year's Apex Salty Sweet, including, of course, me versus Leffen. There's also Hacks versus West Balls. And a couple others that are slipping my mind. Do you remember the others? Oh,
Tapo versus Slox.
Yeah.
Bizarro versus Kage.
Oh, yeah.
I'm hyped about that one.
That one will be crazy.
Sick. Yeah, that's my most anticipated one.
Right.
So, you talk about this one first.
Okay. Well, I just want to say, oh, hold on, the timer isn't started.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, let me start that. I just want to say that Leffen started all the trash talk between us, and all I was doing was defending myself. But when it comes to the disrespect level that this guy brings to the table, I was not having that. I was like, I'm not gonna just sit here and let you like post this shit about me like without saying something in response. So I had to give something, and I'm honestly confident I can beat him in Fox Dittos as well. Like, a lot of people, I've seen plenty of people say, oh my god, this is no match. Like, but the funny thing to me is the top level players that I've talked to, they always say, oh, that could go either way. But like, the random noobs are always like, oh man, Leffen's got that in the bag. But people don't realize there's so much that goes into like a high level match. It's not just the fact that Leffen is a top 10 player and I'm only top 30 or whatever, like, and we're fighting each other. Like, there's so much else going on, and he's not that good at Fox Dittos, if I'm being blunt and honest right now. So I think I got that in the bag. So that's,
I
just
think the pressure's on him more so.
Exactly. Like, and I don't think he's the type of player that he doesn't have enough respect for me to like put time in to like get good at that match. You know what I mean? Like, he's gonna take it like a walk in the park, and I really think I'm gonna mess him up for it. So
do you think you're the favorite, or do you just
have a shot? I can't put myself as the favorite with any like realistic like unbiased point of view. Like, that's not possible. I'm not the favorite by any means, but for people thinking it's gonna be free for Leffen, like, they're sadly mistaken.
No, I think when people ask me how it's going to go, I say Leffen's the better player, but Chilean could win. And it's just because there's all kinds of pressure on it. You know, and then you're good at the Ditto, and he's probably not respecting you enough. So
yeah,
it could go either way, for sure.
Yeah.
I'm also hyped about Tapo versus Slox. Tapo is a maniac with his money, dude.
Yeah,
I think he only works
crazy
to pay for money matches, dude. Like, at this point, it seems that way. Dude, because I don't care how much money he's making at NASA, dude. He's blowing half a paycheck at least on all these crazy money matches.
Yeah.
And he's training hard. He's playing with Mango. He's playing with Lucky. He's playing with Mike Hayes. Not right now, but he does it.
Right.
I'm going to be coaching him during the match. So I got to, like, study him up, too.
Yeah, yeah.
So it's going to be hype. Kage versus Biz is going to be crazy.
Yeah.
That's my favorite match so far.
Yeah.
And then who we got? Hacks versus West Balls?
Hacks and West
Balls. I don't care about that match.
Yeah,
dude, that fake hype. I hate fake hype, dude.
Yeah.
You and Leffen is hype. Slop. Hate each other. Biz and Kage, I'm sure they want to go at it.
Right.
But Hacks and West Balls,
it's,
man,
fake.
That's,
it's
just
fake
hype.
And I think a lot of people realize that
West Balls lose for starting that fake hype.
Yeah, no, I totally agree. But regardless, I think they're all good matches. Like, none of the matches are just like a clean, like, oh, this person's gonna win, like, regardless kind of thing. So it's definitely gonna be a really fun, salty sweet, for sure.
Yeah, no, it's gonna be great.
So that's pretty much it for us. Pretty good episode, and I think we're gonna do this live a lot more often. Because that was pretty fun. Do you want to talk about your channel, Hugs?
Oh yeah, yeah. So I have my own channel. It's twitch.tv/hugs86. You can see this cool little Hugs Bro emote. Basically, I run. I do critiques of viewer videos, so they come into my stream and they submit it. And I look over their match one-on-one from my experience with the game, and I tell them how to get better, what they're doing wrong. And it's helped a lot of people. A lot of people have told me they've been doing a whole lot better at their tournaments versus their friends, things like that. So you can learn a lot. I think it's the only channel of its kind. And, like, I don't take my shirt off for, like, gimmicks. Like, I just do straight up what I'm doing. I help you get better.
Right.
And, yeah, so, I mean, I think I give really good advice. I've been coaching other top players for their matches, so you should trust me with that too. So just come by twitch.tv/hugs86, follow. If you like it, you can sub, and it'll be a big help. So
awesome.
Cool. Yeah,
sweet. All right,
Mondays,
guys,
Wednesdays and Fridays are the main days. Mondays guaranteed.
Sweet. All right, awesome. Thanks so much for joining me, Hugs. I think we're all done here. Thanks to everyone who tuned in. We're definitely going to try to make this way more regular, especially since we can do it live now. That's a lot of fun. So thanks for tuning in, y'all. All
right. See you.
Peace.
See you guys.